God. Praise the Lord. I will bless the name of Jesus, and He deserves all glory, all praise, all honor. And I'm just thrilled today to know that we're His and that He knows who we are. We're never alone in this world. You might think you are sometimes. Sometimes we have people leave us, go away, and we don't see Him for a long, long time. But Jesus said, I'll never leave you, and I'll never forsake you. So I'm glad He's with us today. The song says it is love, and I'm glad it's the love of God that holds all this stuff together. Amen. There is something in my soul, keeps the shadows all away. It is love, my Savior's love. Nothing lightens every burden, gives me gladness day by day.
Amen. So I'm going to lift up the name of Jesus.
Would you do that today with your voice? Just lift up your wonderful name. I'm gonna lift up the name of Jesus.
Oh. Good morning, everybody. Well, I didn't think I had a song today. I didn't think I had this little adapter that attaches to my phone. It's on the car, so. And take it over. My sister was yesterday, and I thought I took it in the house. I want that little one, but it was there, so. Try it.
Savior came and he took my blame.
through the darkness, now I can finally see. Paid the price for my freedom, hallelujah. No more chains on me, 'cause the Savior came and He took the blame, changed everything. I'm so glad, aren't you? Hallelujah. Yes, the Savior came and He took the blame, changed everything. Hallelujah. I can sing, can't you?
I can sing about His forgiveness. I can praise until the sun goes down. I can say I am the witness. I was there when His love came down. I can sing about His forgiveness. I can praise until the sun goes down.
We've all gone wrong, but
the Savior came, and he took the blame. Changed everything.
I'm so glad he changes everything.
Yes, the Savior came, and he took the blame. Changes everything.
Hallelujah. I can sing, right?
I can sing about his forgiveness. I can praise until the sun goes down. I can say I am the witness. I was there when his love came down. Love came down on
that day.
Love came down on me. Love broke through the darkness. Now I can finally see. You paid the price for our freedom. No more chains on me. 'Cause the Savior came, and he took the blame. He changed everything.
Hallelujah.
Thank you, Jesus. Our Savior came, and he took the blame. Changed everything.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Sing with me.
I can sing about his forgiveness. I can praise him till the sun goes down.
Let your body and your face and everything else Let it proclaim His glory. Don't be ashamed of Jesus. Don't be ashamed of what He's done for you. Don't be a secret Christian, as Pastor Ron says, like, you know, I'm a secret mission. No, you're not. Man, you know what? You can't hide a light under a bushel. You can't put a jar under a candle. You know, we can't hide ourselves. Either we're the real deal or we're not. And we don't need to just stand up and say, I love God. I believe in God. I'm no better than anyone else. I, you know, I'm only saved by His grace and His mercy, but I love Jesus. I love you. Amen. I'm not preaching. I'm just giving God some glory. Give it over to Pastor Ron. That's what he gets for asking me to sing, and I get all excited. God bless you.
Great song. His love came down like rain from heaven. Now this song we sang here, but I even got a backup audience on this song. So, you know, don't think too much about it, but I got people cheering in the background and the whole deal. So here we go. All right. God, you're so good to me. You've always been so good to me. I sing through eternity. God, you're so good. God, you're so good to me. You've always been so good to me. I sing through eternity.
God, you're so good.
2 Peter, and open your Bibles. Second Peter, chapter 2. Get there before me, just wait on me, okay? 2 Peter, chapter 2. It's been such a beautiful weekend. Friday was beautiful. In fact, all week was really good for me as far as doing lawns and stuff. I didn't overly sweat. And that kid that works for me doesn't have to sweat too much. He flies even faster. So I appreciate him, God sending him. Somebody asked me, says, how's he doing? I said, he's a godsend. And he really is. Appreciate the young man. Good boy, 15 years old, seems to have his head on right. And just grateful, especially when we live in a world where a lot of kids don't have their head on right. They're all going in directions that maybe they should not be going in. But I want to read a couple of scriptures here. And this is one of those messages that, as a pastor, sometimes you don't even want to have to share it. But I think it's necessary. Not for your sake, maybe for my own. I know God has a plan for all of us. And, I've been telling you for quite some time now that I'm just trying to hear what he's saying to me. And so whatever comes out, I praise him. If it's me, throw it to the side and act as though it was never spoken. But if you can sense and feel the presence of God in it, then eat it, swallow it, chew it, digest it. Make it part of your everyday life so that you can grow in the knowledge and the grace that God has intended. Because I really believe in my heart, it's God's intention to grow all of us up. Not just preachers. And too many times we have preachers that hold on to truths so that they can appear to be wiser or smarter than others. And I don't think that's right. I think you ought to give your people everything God has given you if you can. Sometimes we have not the venue or the opportunity to share as much as we would probably need to with the folks that are with us. So when we're here on a Sunday morning, we have to try to share as much as we can, try to pour into us as much as we can, because we need God's help. We, Brother Joe and I and Tim, Chris, we did the night here on Wednesday night, we were here, and we had a chance to view a message that spoke to all of us. Just a powerful word from the Lord. And I need to hear from God myself. So it's important to me. But in 2 Peter chapter 2, beginning in verse 4, it says these words, "For if God spared not the angels that sinned, but cast them down into hell and delivered them into the chains of darkness, to be reserved unto judgment, and spared not the old world, but saved Noah, the eighth person, a preacher of righteousness, bringing in the flood upon the world of the ungodly, and turning the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah into ashes, condemned them with an overflow, making them an example unto those that after should live ungodly, and delivered just Lot, vexed with the filthy conversation of the wicked, for that righteous man dwelling among them, in seeing and hearing, vexed his righteous soul from day to day with their unlawful deeds. Now we all know this, or we should know this. God knows how to deliver us. He knows how to get us out of the things that we get ourselves into. Right? Because it's not the devil's fault. And it's not other people's fault. Usually when we're in a mess, it's our fault. Would everybody agree with that? Every time I've made a mistake or sinned or done something that was contrary to the will of God, I did it because I wanted to. Now, I think of the Apostle Paul. He said, that which I don't want to do, I do. And he said, that which I should be doing, I don't do. So we all have that warfare and that battle going on in each one of our lives. We from time to time, do what Lot did in this setting. He vexed his soul. Something was not right with the decisions that he had made to leave Abraham and to go down and dwell in the cities of Sodom and Gomorrah. Was not really God's plan or intention for anybody. God never meant for anybody to go dwell in a sinful place. God never meant for the creation of the world to dwell in a sinful place. It's his will that all should come to repentance, that everybody should be saved. That's what God wants. That's his desire. If it was not his desire, he would have never sent Jesus to Calvary's cross to pay for it. Does that make sense to you? So if Jesus went to the cross and paid for our sin, then it was God's intention and God's desire and God's design that the whole world would be saved. Now I'm glad I'm part of that part that got saved. How about you? Wave at me if you're glad you're saved. I'm so glad I know him as my own personal Savior. I don't back up from that. I'm not apologizing for being saved. I'm glad I'm saved. But am I perfect? No. But I do have a perfect Savior. And he can bring me to that place of perfection. And I'm not talking about without error, but he can bring me to that place of maturity where that I don't vex my soul like Lot did. Now, Lot made some bad choices. Would you agree with that? In fact, this whole chapter that we're going to look at in Genesis 19 was a chapter filled with bad choices. So when we get into it, let me read some scripture to you, but I put a little definition down, and I looked up the word vex on my my Bible computer thing, And really it means to labor down or to wear out with toil or to oppress. And then this is definition according to Rainey. Take it for what it's worth. To dwell in a place that grace has delivered you from. To dwell in a place that grace has delivered you from. God brought us out of darkness into marvelous light. Walk in the light and you won't feel the desires of the flesh, the scripture says. In 1 John chapter 2 and verse 15 it says this, love not the world, neither the things that are in the world. If any man love the world, the love of the Father is not in him. Matthew 6 and 24 said, no man can serve two masters. For either he will hate the one and love the other, or else he will hold to the one and despise the other. You cannot serve God and mammon. Romans 12 and 2 says, be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Galatians 1 and 10 says this, for do I now persuade men or God? Or do I seek to please men? For if I yet please men, I should not be the servant of Christ. And then James chapter 4 and verse 4 says this, ye adulterers and adulteresses, know ye not that the friendship of this world is enmity with God? Whosoever therefore will be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. I don't know about you, all those verses are telling us we're supposed to be in this world, but not of it. We're supposed to be dwellers here that are shining our light in the dark place. How many would agree with you that the world's a dark place right now? Now there's light that's shining. It's shining in different places, and probably places that I'm not aware of, places that I don't know about. I don't know what goes on in little hovels of Cuba or in the little back, you know, little towns and in the little rooms in China. I'm not aware of all the things that may go on in India. I mean, I've been there too many times to know that there's not some things that are going on there that are not of God. I don't know all that stuff, but I do know this, that God's light has shined into the world. And there are some folks that have said yes to the light and no to the darkness and are walking in ways that please God. Now, those that live in those towns that I've talked about, those little places that are out and away from us, they sometimes are more blessed than we are because they have less distractions. Would you agree with that? I would say in America, there are more things to pull you away from God than to pull you to God. Some folks might not agree with that, but from what I see and from what I can gather, now there are things that will pull you to God, but you've got to spend time with Him. You've got to be in His presence. You've got to be willing to lay aside worldly things and things that distract you and take you away and allow yourself to be in God's presence daily. Not just on Sunday. I mean, it's a great place to come. You know, and we can get up here, we can sing the songs, and we can dance, and we can do all those wonderful, glorious things while we're here. But we all know that when we leave this place, that's where the rubber meets the road. When you walk out that door in a, you know, a little while, you're going to walk back into a world that's full of darkness. A world that's got all kinds of things to try to pull at you and to drag you away. And it doesn't just, see, God tells us that the thief comes to steal and to kill and to destroy. We realize that. But who's he stealing, killing, and destroying? He's already got the world. So if he's stealing, killing, and destroying, it must be he's pulling it, the saints. Those that have given their heart and life to Jesus Christ, those are the ones that he's trying to steal, kill, and destroy from. And you can come in here and you can shout glory and hallelujah, praise the Lord, but I promise you, by the time the middle of the week shows up, the devil's hit you four ways to Sunday. He hit you on this side and he's hit you on that side, and he's tried his dead level best to get you to quit, to get you to stop, and to get you to go in the other direction and tell you that, you know, you don't need to go to church and you don't need to be part of the family of God and you don't need to be good to your family. You know, they don't treat you right anyway, so you might as well just say heck with all of them and just go on your little merry way and do your thing. And listen, you've got to look the devil in the eye and say, shut up, devil. I have a great Savior that's going to give me joy. That's going to give me happiness. That's going to make me glad. That's going to lift me up when I'm down. That's going to encourage me when I'm discouraged. That's going to heal me when I'm sick. That's going to deliver me when I'm caught up in some type of captivity. He's going to help me. If God can deliver a man from a lion's den and deliver a boy from a raging giant and deliver three Hebrew boys out of a fiery furnace, these little things that we got to face should not even be a problem. But they are. When I look at them, in fact, turn with me to Genesis 19, would you? Everybody all right? Genesis 19. Now, if you don't get nothing out of this today, just let me preach it to myself, okay? I realize that I'm still human. Isn't that a shock? We look at preachers sometimes, they think they've been dehumanized. You know, he probably never has any problems. Everything just wonderful, wonderful for him because, you know, he's a preacher. Let me tell you something. Usually, it's the preacher that gets hit the most often. Kill the head, the body will die. Stop and think about it. That's why when Jesus was destroying the powers of darkness, the scripture says that his heel crushed the, not the body, but the head of the serpent. And he just, so if our enemy has been destroyed, why do we give him so much power? In Genesis chapter 19, there came two angels to Sodom and Eve. And Lot sat at the gate of Sodom, and Lot, seeing them, rose up to meet them, and he bowed himself with his face toward the ground. And he said, "Behold now, my lords, turn in, I pray thee, into the servant's house, and tarry all night, and wash your feet, and ye shall rise up early, and go on your ways." And they said, "Nay, but we will abide in the streets all night." And he pressed upon them greatly, and they turned in unto him, and entered into his house, and he made them a feast, and did bake unleavened bread, and they did eat. Listen, your soul becomes vexed when you know what to do, but don't do it. You look at those verses, Lot shouldn't even have been there. I mean, he is the nephew of the father of the faith, Abraham. He should have been hanging out with him. And yet he decides that he's going down to the well-watered gardens of Sodom and Gomorrah. Now, if you understand where I'm at right now, the well-watered gardens of Sodom mean to me that the world is very alluring. There's some things that will draw you in. I mean, look at all the stuff that's in just America that you can go see, that you can go enjoy, that just can pull at you. I mean, there's lakes, there's rivers, there's all kinds of distractions that can actually pull you in that direction, to the place where that you become so consumed with what you're doing. And I was thinking about this week. You know, there are some folks that God has blessed beyond what they probably ever imagined they would be blessed. And they have an opportunity right now to really be a blessing to the church, but they don't go. When they had nothing, when things were tough and they were scraping pennies and trying to pay bills and do things that, you know, they didn't know how they were going to do them, you never see them gone. They were always in church. They were always doing something for the kingdom's sake. They were always busy about the work of God. And I'm not saying to you that you need to be 24/7 doing something for God, because sometimes you got your job to work, you got families to take care of, you got all that stuff that's out there. And you know what? Don't think for one moment that God doesn't understand that. I think sometimes we think, you know, God's just mean and he just wants to take up all my time. No, he just wants to help you in the time that you have to become as much as you can be for not only you, your family, but also for him. He wants to bless you. I believe with all my heart, God wants to bless you beyond your wildest imaginations. I really feel in my heart, God wants to give you the car, wants to give you the house, wants to give you the clothes, wants to give you the bank account. I believe with all my heart, he wants to give you all that stuff. But he doesn't want all that stuff to just take over. He's the one that gives the blessing. And, I was reading this week in Chronicles, and it said, when the children of Israel